the late 1990s, most British businesses still rely on faxes, phone calls and piles of paper. But at the back of the office, quietly humming away, there's a beige box that is changing how business is done, and it's running Microsoft Exchange Server 5.5. Email stopped being something you dialed into at home or used at university. It became the everyday heartbeat of British business. And for Microsoft, it became something even bigger. Email became their business. Hi, I'm Kyle, and in this video, you'll see how one piece of software dramatically changed how British businesses began to communicate. Back Office 4.5 contained Microsoft Exchange Server 5.5. This wasn't just a piece of old Microsoft software. This absolutely revolutionized how businesses communicated. It's easy to forget, but back in the 1990s, most businesses weren't using email correctly, if at all. They'd have a copy of Outlook Express on the internet computer, and they'd maybe use it once or twice a day. And then came Microsoft Exchange 5.5, bundled with Back Office 4.5, and it enabled businesses to grasp hold of email and communicate globally. It's a system I worked on from the very start of my career, and I want to show you in this video how email became Microsoft's business and everybody else's business too. So let's go back to where it all started, before Exchange and Outlook, to where email in business began. In the early 90s, Microsoft provided email to over 32,000 employees via Xenix Mail, Microsoft's own internal email system built on its customized version of Unix. Across the company, 160 Xenix Mail servers ran on 386, 486 class computers with 16 megabytes of RAM and 300 to 600 megabytes of disk space, handling around 650 to 750,000 messages a day, roughly 4.5 gigabytes of mail traffic. Most staff would telnet into those servers to check their email, except the Microsoft Mail team, who used their own software as a client. For its time, that was a serious system, but it was creaking under the weight of Microsoft's growth. The system was reliable enough for small groups, but it simply wouldn't scale. And for a company that was supposed to be defining the future of business software, that was a problem. Back in 1988, Microsoft exec Paul Moritz sent an email titled, "Eating Our Own Dog Food," to test manager Brian Valentine, urging the company to run its own products internally, so that they should use their own unfinished products first and feel the pain of their own bugs before customers do. So when Valentine then operationalized it, famously standing up an internal server share called /dogfood, the practice spread across Microsoft engineering. Microsoft decided to build it, use it internally, and prove it worked within the company before selling it to anyone else. The first proof of concept appeared in the early 1990s under the codename Mercury. But at first, it looked impossible. The development team struggled to scale it beyond 25 users. Performance was so bad that it became an inside joke. The engineers kept Exchange alive only as an MIR, or Microsoft internal release. Eventually, Microsoft formed a dedicated performance and scalability team to rescue the project. They focused on rewriting the mail store, improving mail routing, and re-architecting the directory service. The result was a completely new system built by Microsoft's Information Technology Group, an X400-based client-server mail system that supported X500 directory services. This was the birth of Microsoft Exchange. By April 1996, every single one of Microsoft's employees had been migrated from Xenix Mail to Exchange Server 4.0, just weeks before the product launched to customers. And that internal directory, the one built for Exchange, would eventually evolve into Active Directory, the cornerstone of Windows 2000 and everything that came after. What started as a painful internal experiment had turned into a complete reimagining of how Microsoft, and soon, every business would handle communication. Exchange wasn't just a new mail system, it was the foundation for Microsoft's future in enterprise computing. Early deployments were challenging, performance could be unpredictable, and many customers quickly found themselves installing service packs, 5 of them in total, to keep it stable. Exchange 4 had been built around X400 for message transport, and an X500 style directory for managing users. Solid enterprise-grade technologies. But suddenly businesses wanted to connect directly to the outside world, and that meant using SMTP, the protocol that powered internet mail. As one engineer put it, after implementing several groundbreaking protocols such as SMTP and LDAP version 2, this was certainly not a dot release. The idea of Exchange 4.1 was dropped entirely. Instead, Microsoft decided to leap straight into a new version, a release that would fully embrace internet standards and introduce a brand new web-based email client. That release evolved into Exchange Server 5.0, which was released in the first quarter of 1997. On May 23rd, Microsoft released Exchange Server 5. With the help of an add-in called the Internet Mail Connector, Exchange could convert native mail formats, MAPI X400 style addressing and transport, and internet formats, SMTP transport, MIME body encoding, so that messages could flow between internal Exchange mailboxes and external SMTP destinations. Exchange 5 also introduced a brand new management console, a huge usability improvement over the original 4 tools. It was cleaner, faster, and easier to manage. Exchange Client 5 for email and Schedule Plus as calendar were designed to take advantage of Exchange's new internet and collaboration features. But the biggest breakthrough was initially created in 1995 by Microsoft Program Manager Tom McCann on the Exchange Server team. This was something called Exchange Web Access, which allowed anyone with an Exchange mailbox to access their email through a web browser. That might sound humdrum now, but in 1997, that was extraordinary. No special software, no VPN, no configuration, just a browser and a connection. And a little later, Microsoft renamed it to Outlook Web Access, or OWA. And that name stuck. However, most small businesses in the UK were running, at best, an ISDN connection to the internet in 1997, which was a dial-up connection. It connected when a user inside the network requested access, meaning an employee could not connect from the outside into the office. Exchange 5 laid the groundwork for everything that followed, but as powerful as it was, Microsoft wasn't done. Later that year, they released a version that would truly define Exchange for years to come, Exchange Server 5.5. Before that though, it's worth remembering what Microsoft was up against in the late 90s. There were many ways to send email back then, some better than others, and each had their loyal followers. Lotus Notes was a huge system, not just email, but databases, workflows, applications, and discussion forums all rolled into one. But Notes wasn't cheap, and it wasn't simple. It tended to dominate in big enterprises with deep pockets and full-time administrators. Then there was Novell GroupWise. Technically solid, well-engineered, and tightly integrated with NetWare, but again, it just didn't fit comfortably into the Windows world. Outside of those enterprise systems, the POP3 providers were starting to make noise too. Services like BT Internet, Yahoo Mail, and FreeServe here in the UK. They were fine for home users, but they weren't built for business. So Microsoft had started to capture a clear gap, make something powerful for big enterprises, but simple and integrated enough for small businesses. That balance, plus the rise of Outlook and back office server, is what helped Exchange dominate so quickly. Las Vegas, Comdex Fall. November 1997, Microsoft takes to the stage to announce a new release in its back office family, Exchange Server 5.5. By this time, big names were already standardizing on it. AMD, Amgen, AT&T, British Telecom, Charles Schwab, Dow Chemical, the US Air Force, Siemens Nixdorf, Volkswagen Xerox, and even the Swiss government. One of the key features that made Exchange 5.5 so powerful for business was its X500 based directory service. This wasn't simply Microsoft inventing something new. X500 was already the backbone of many enterprise email systems, including those used by governments and large corporations. Because Exchange spoke the same language, it could link directly into those existing networks, allowing organizations to migrate their users without ripping everything out and starting again. X500 provided the most advanced directory structure of its time. It effectively set the blueprint for Microsoft's own Active Directory, which would arrive a few years later and become the foundation for Windows domains and enterprise identity management. Exchange 5.5 was the first version sold in two editions, Standard and Enterprise. The Standard Edition kept the familiar 16GB database limit and came with all the usual connectors, the Site Connector, MS Mail Connector, Internet Mail Service, Internet News Service, plus tools to interoperate with CC Mail, Lotus Notes, and Novell GroupWise. The Enterprise Edition took things further. It supported databases up to 16TB. Practically impossible, but on the marketing copy, this was another level. Exchange 5.5 also advanced internet standards. It added support for IMAP 4, LDAP version 3, and a new version of Outlook Web Access that finally included calendar support. For the first time, employees could check and schedule meetings straight from a browser, anywhere, anytime. And behind the scenes, Exchange introduced deleted item recovery. This feature was a godsend to a system administrator. Now you no longer had to retrieve accidentally deleted emails from backups. You could keep up to 30 days of emails that had been deleted from the trash can, which in real terms meant 60 days of recovery for the employee. And alongside its 5.5 came Outlook 8.3, which was more commonly known as Outlook 97. This was more polished and integrated client that brought all of Exchange's new features together, messaging, calendaring and collaboration, all in one interface. Small businesses that had back office 4.5 had an extra bonus. Outlook 98 was included in that package for free, meaning no additional license was required to connect the client to Exchange Server. Exchange 5.5 was the turning point. It was the version that made Microsoft the default provider of business email for the next two decades. Looking back now, I think the real magic of Exchange, especially here in the UK, wasn't the technology, but it was how Microsoft marketed it. With Back Office Server, everything came in one box: Windows NT, Exchange, SQL Server, Proxy Server, all pre-configured for a low-cost price. This reduced the barrier of entry to IT systems for small and medium businesses. Suddenly, the kind of tools that could only be afforded by an enterprise corporation were being used in businesses of 20 and 30 people. Microsoft had already won half the battle by the mid-1990s. On every desk was a copy of Word and Excel, and with that came an installation of Microsoft Outlook. It made the move and connection to Exchange really simple. But more than that, Microsoft was new and exciting then. It wasn't a dusty old mainframe system. It had a GUI, nice graphics. It was a system people wanted to use. They had the price point, the polish, and the momentum. And with the advent of the internet and SMTP, everything came together at once for Microsoft. And that's why, in my view, by the end of the 1990s, Microsoft didn't just dominate email, they had defined it. They gave small and medium businesses the same communication power as a global business. And once Exchange was in, it stayed in because it worked, and it worked with everything else that they had. So that's how email became Microsoft's business and everybody else's business too. If you've enjoyed this video, give me a subscribe because it means lots to me. And I'll see you on the next video. Ta-da!